Hi, before we start exploring VHDL, it's important to understand some basics about FPGA. This knowledge is important because the code we write in VHDL will ultimately run on the FPGA devices. So let's understand some fundamental concept of FPGA in this video. An FPGA or field programmable gate array is a reprogrammable device composed of logical gates such as AND gate, OR gate, XOR gate, NOT gate, etc. The term field programmable means that the devices can be reconfigured multiple times to implement different logical functions. Modern FPGAs contains more than just logical gates. Now there are few additional elements commonly found in the modern FPGAs. Configurable logical blocks, CLBs. These are the basic building blocks of an FPGA containing logical gates and flip-flops that can be configured to implement various logical functions. Input-output blocks, normally called as IOBs. These blocks manages the interface between the FPGA and the external devices such as sensors or displays, etc. Block RAM or BRAM, this is dedicated memory within the FPGA that can be used to store the data. DSP blocks, normally called as digital signal processing, DSP blocks, are specialized blocks within the FPGA designed for performing the complex mathematical operations quickly. Next is clock management resources. These resources help manage and distribute the clock signals within the FPGA. These elements work together to make the FPGA highly flexible and customizable with a wide range of applications. All FPGA devices consist of logical gates, registers, and configurable routing. Most modern FPGAs also include built-in block memory resources for implementing RAMs and ROMs within the device. They also typically feature PLLs, that is phase lock loops for clock frequency scaling along the frequency multiplexing and division. Some FPGAs, including dedicated arithmetic blocks for tasks like multiplication, addition, subtraction, etc. To cater to the diverse range of application for FPGAs, vendors often add other elements into their FPGAs, known as hard peripheral blocks. While these blocks may not be that much configurable or flexible as other FPGA resources, but they play the important role in specific applications. Some FPGAs include built-in ADCs, analog-to-digital converters, or DDR memory controllers, etc. For example, the lattice semiconductors cross-link FPGAs features MIPI interfaces that can transmit video streams from cameras to the MIPI displays. These built-in features like ADCs, DDR memory controllers, and MIPI interfaces are the example of the hard peripherals in the FPGA. The key concept is to understand that the most of these elements in the FPGAs are fully programmable. However, it's important to note that the hard peripherals like ADCs, MIPI interfaces, and DDR IOs may have the dedicated IO pins. So, you will need to pay attention to these details in these devices' datasheets. As we progress throughout this course, we will learn more about the flexibility of the FPGAs. The two major FPGA vendors are Intel and Xilinx. However, there are several other companies that manufacture FPGA. You can also find FPGAs from companies like Lattice Semiconductors, Macrosemi, and even Microchips, among others. The beauty of programming FPGA is that you can use VHDL for all of them. When describing an FPGA, it is important to understand its basic structure. While all the FPGAs consist of logics and registers, these resources are just placed randomly within the device. If you keep an FPGA under the microscope, you should see the repeating patterns of tiny cells. These cells, numbering in the thousands, are identical to each other and form the basic building blocks of the FPGA. We refer to these as the configurable logical elements, or CLBs for short. Each CLB contains the carefully organized logic and registers. This diagram shows the example of a CLB. You just need to note that the different FPGA vendors uses different names for the CLBs. For instance, Intel calls this adaptive logical modules, while Xilinx has its own terminology. The CLB contains a lookup table, LUT in general we say. You can see it in this example where we have the four input LUTs with inputs A, B, C, and D. The lookup table is just like a truth table and is used to implement a combination of the logical functions. For instance, in this example, the LUT can be configured to act as a 4-input AND gate or a 4-input OR gate. It can also implement more complex 4-input logical functions that require multiple logical gates. The lookup table LUT is a powerful and flexible component within the CLBs. FPGAs do not have the individual gates like AND gate or OR gate. Instead, they have the lookup tables to implement all the combination logics. The output of the lookup table feeds into the D-type flip-flops, also known as 1-bit register, and the output of the flip-flop also goes into the multiplexer. The flip-flop receives the clock and reset signal, and its output is connected to the multiplexer, which acts as a simple switch to select which input goes to the output F. And that's the basic structure of an FPGA. In summary, a typical CLB includes a lookup table for implementing the combinational logical functions, a flip-flop or register, and a multiplexer. The exact content of the CLB can vary between the FPGA vendors and the devices. So it's important to refer to the device datasheet for the specific details. For example, your device might have a 6-input lookup table or multiple flip-flops in its CLB. This slide demonstrates the arrangement of the CLBs and other resources within the FPGA. The gray lines represent the programmable interconnects, these facilitating the connections between the various FPGA resources. Highlighted in red are the I/O cells, which directly link to the I/O pins of the FPGA. Interconnects between the I/O cells and the CLBs are also displayed here. Additionally, this slide showcases the PLLs for clock frequency scaling and a RAM block for the memory implementation. It's important to note that this diagram is simplified representation. In reality, FPGA contains thousands of CLBs and hundreds of input-output cells, along with many more resources which we are showing here. However, if you understand this basic concept, then combining the larger FPGAs becomes straightforward because a larger device simply contains more of these blocks. FPGAs are valuable for implementing custom digital circuits. For example, in data acquisition scenario, where data from the several high-speed ADCs need processing, FPGAs can filter the data, perform the real-time calculations like FFTs, or store it in the memory. Unlike the microcontrollers with the fixed architecture, FPGAs offer immense flexibility in their capabilities. For instance, in the microcontrollers, you are limited to a set number of peripherals like counters, timers, UARTs, and SPI peripherals. However, in the FPGA, you can have many peripherals as needed by you, provided you the highest flexibility of using all the resources or CLBs. This flexibility allows you to create your own peripherals or modules to suit your specific needs. As an example, we will create our own UART peripherals by the end of this course. Additionally, you can even design a basic microcontrollers in VHDL to run on the FPGA and act as a microcontroller. Another approach is to utilize the pre-made modules, also known as IP blocks. FPGA vendors such as Intel or Xilinx provide a variety of IP blocks for free. Some of them are freely available, but there are some which are paid as well. Once you are proficient in the FPGA design, you can create your own modules and you can share them with others for their designs. It's important to write the reusable VHDL code even if you don't intend to distribute your modules among others. This way, when you need a new FPGA design in the future, you can easily incorporate your reusable modules into your new designs. We will cover that how to design those reusable modules, which is valuable practice. FPGAs don't have a fixed hardware structure. They are fully reconfigurable by design. As we discussed earlier, FPGA consists of many configurable logical blocks that can be programmed to perform the various digital functions. Regarding the I/O pins, they can be configured as inputs, outputs, bidirectional pins, or remain tri-stated. You can assign any function to almost any input-output pin. Additionally, most Intel and Xilinx FPGAs allows you to set the input-output drive strength for each GPIO line in milliamperes to control the error rate of the signal. In summary, there is no fixed hardware structure in FPGAs. You can configure them to perform almost any function. And this is the main advantage of FPGAs, that they are completely reconfigurable and you can develop any sort of your system in a single boot. Think you are building a cool new gadget and you get everything wired up and working, but then an amazing idea for an extra feature pops into your mind, or even customer demanded. With the regular ICs, that may need to start all over again. Might be wiping out the old circuit boards and building a new one. But that's where the FPGAs comes in. FPGAs are like super flexible building blocks. They can completely change their functions on the go without needing to touch the circuit board itself. Today's FPGA are also pretty speedy. They can run at clock speeds of 200 MHz, sometimes even faster. While that might not seem super impressive compared to these some processors that can hit speeds of gigabyte range or gigahertz, but FPGA have a secret weapon, that is parallel processing. Imagine a computer with just one person working on the task one after another. That's kind of how a regular process works. Now consider a computer with hundreds of people working on the task and all at once. And that's the power of parallel processing. And this lets the FPGA tackle the huge amount of data extremely fast, which making them the perfect fit for the situations where information needs to process super fast. A great example is processing audio and video signals, where a lot of data involved in those tasks and no problem for the FPGAs, which is why they are often used for the communication devices as well. The FPGA configurability allows for virtually unlimited data path widths. For example, inside the FPGA, you can simply create a 32-bit bus between the modules. But if you feel that is insufficient for your project, then you can double it to 64 bits or even further to the 128 bits to achieve the necessary bandwidth for your project. This level of flexibility is not achievable with the processors because their data path is fixed. Usually, this width is either 16 bits or 32 bits or 64 bits in the modern processors. Because of their parallel natures, FPGAs are better for intensive data processing applications that involve continuous calculations. Even though FPGAs are powerful tools, but still there are some situations where they might not be a best choice for your projects. For example, the cost can be one factor. FPGAs tends to be more expensive than the microcontrollers. If you are working on the tight budget and your project does not require the full capabilities of an FPGA, then a microcontroller might be a more economical option for you. Another consideration is the type of task your project involves. FPGA leads at handling multiple tasks simultaneously. I mean parallel processing. However, if your projects involve a lot of tasks happening one after another, like sequential processing, then a microcontroller might be a better fit. Microcontrollers are often optimized for these type of tasks. Finally, the speed and the latency, generally says delays, are the important factors as well. While FPGAs can be fast, speed isn't always the most important thing. If your project does not require the lightning fast processing and extremely low delays, then a microcontrollers might be a simpler and a cheaper option for you. But the good news is that the reality is changing. Now the FPGA prices are dropping and they have the smaller and more affordable options available that can compete with the microcontroller's cost. This means that the FPGAs are becoming more attractive for even budget conscious projects. So while the FPGAs are the powerful tools, but it's important to consider the cost, task type and speed requirements for your projects before making a decision. In the next session, we will be talking about how these FPGAs gets programmed, what is the design flow, and what is the implementation flow. We will briefly talk about the important terms and features required in the whole process. So stay tuned for the updates. If you did not subscribe till now, then please do subscribe to learn and grow community for the regular updates. If this video is informative, then please like this video, comment on video, and don't forget to share. Thank you for watching.